Education at Kansas State University, and I'll let my colleagues introduce themselves.
I'm Sandra Avalosa, also with her in the
And Kelly Briggs, in the same Center for Student and Professional Services is the name of our office.
So you are in the Presenting the Technology Puzzle workshop. We were actually discussing right before everyone came in. It seems like it's actually kind of a timely topic because Dr. Morales was talking about both how students like to use technology and how we also know that it's really important that students actually have personal connections on campus. So as I was listening to that, I thought about that and I was going, yeah, absolutely. It's difficult to find a balance. What we're gonna do today is we're gonna talk a little bit about what our office at K-State has done, kind of the resources that we've used, and then what we really wanna do is kind of at the end, what we want to do is give you a little bit of an opportunity to think about the technology resources on campus where you work and how you might be able to use some of the ideas that we've used on our campus, but then also your own ideas and customize what it looks like for you to use the technology on your campus to reach students and work with them in a holistic advising approach. So we wanted to start out with a few definitions here. We wanted to talk about there are basically four different resources technology-wise that we use on our campus. The first one, our technology, our IT people at K-State have worked really hard and put together an advising center with our student information system, so which we refer to as CASIS. So if we talk about that through the rest of the presentation, CASIS is Kansas State University's student information system. Academic records, basically all of the data about students is contained in the CASIS Advisor Center. It's really important for us as we're working with students to have all of that information on hand so that we can determine how to really customize what we're talking with students about and really advise each individual student where they're at. The institutional website. I'm guessing most of your schools have a website. We do feel like this is very important. That's probably the best and easiest place that students can find information. Where students find information, that's how they know how to get a hold of different on-campus, in-person resources to help with different issues like the ones that Dr. Morales was talking about today. Learning management system, Canvas. Sandra, do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Canvas is our learning management system. All of the courses have some sort of Canvas component to it. That's where they store grades. They can put a assignments on. Some professors use it, some professors don't, but definitely highly encourage the use of it. And we also have the access to invite students to a particular course that they're not enrolled in. So that's kind of a nice tool. There's a lot of analytics within it too, so if you have something similar, I know Blackboard kind of probably does the same thing, so.
All right, and then SSC Campus, Kelly, you want to talk a little bit about what that looks like?
SSC Campus is the newest platform from EAB, the Educational Advisory Board, that K-State has purchased to use. And it is does a lot of data mining. And so within the SSC Campus, it has tracked the previous 10 years of data for all of our K-State students, and then does predictors in terms of their potential for success in a program based on their past success in certain programs, certain demographics, and then allows us to be able to work with that to make some decisions on how we want to talk to the students and go from there. So it's very much a data mining program that in the way that we're using it in the office. We also use it for scheduling and some other things, but in the terms of this presentation, it's the data mining that we're using.
And we realize that everyone's going to have different types of learning management systems and different types of student information systems. But hopefully this presentation is broad enough that it lets you get a feel for, okay, this is how the College of Education at K-State is using these systems. How can you use your systems at your institution? We're going to start pretty basic. So we have students, they're really versed in technology. It's a very big part of their lives, but they don't come to the university knowing how to use all of our systems. I have so many students who are, you know, juniors, seniors, they've been at K-State for several years, and they still really have no idea how to read a degree audit or things like that. And so one of the things that we start with as far as, we kind of draw a funnel here, you know, where you start with, okay, what do we need to teach everyone as far as our students to be successful at K-State? And then how do we reach out to those students who maybe are more considered at-risk students? And that's where a lot of the data mining comes in. And then practically speaking, using a learning management system to do some interventions with those students. So as far as the education piece, we use the K-State website. So obviously the K-State website's where a lot of the most important information for students to know is. And then K-State Online Canvas, the learning management system. Both of those things together, we use those extensively in our orientation class for the College of Education. So the website gives us program information. It's where they can look up the curriculum guides for their program. Gives them the course catalog. It can help them figure out what semesters courses are offered, what the prerequisites are for those courses. And it gives us campus resources. So if we have students that we need to direct to Lafine Health Center, the health center on campus, if we need to direct students to tutoring on campus, those kinds of things. The resources are all there for students to see, but the problem is helping them figure out where those resources are and helping them know where to look. So then what we do is we take, with the K-State Online Canvas Learning Management System, what it really gives us is it's a vehicle for us to share the information that students need to know to help them learn to navigate the website. Interactive learning opportunities, so each of the sections of the orientation class is taught by an advisor. I really don't, you know, when I get up there to speak to students, I want to make sure that we're doing interactive things and they're not falling asleep. I know that some of the information that we're sharing with them is not necessarily, they don't see it as relevant at the time, but what we try to do is we try to make it very interactive, and so they can see how it actually applies to their other classes. I tell students all the time, we're not making you do this class just so we're making you do this class. This class is aimed to help you succeed in all of your other classes. So, and varied assignment formats. So kind of one of the other things that we do is we try to make sure that within the learning management system, they're doing different types of assignments because those are different types of things that they're going to be seeing in their other classes. The majority of students enrolled are going to be first-year students. We try to get all of our first-year students enrolled in this class because it is so important for them to get to the technology resources early. It's required for admission to the professional program. So basically, by the time they get to their actual education classes, they have to have taken this class. Ideally, they've learned how to use the technology resources long before that. But like I said, that's why we have students enroll basically first semester freshmen, first semester transfer students. We talked about the program requirements and the university technology. Like I said, this is our vehicle to help students learn how to use those technology resources they need to know how to use to succeed at the university. Focuses on interactive learning. Like I said, I try to have students follow along with what we're doing in class. So if I have their degree audit pulled up, we're trying to talk about how to read a degree audit. I try to make sure that they have it pulled up and they're going through it at the same time. Primary learning tools, like I said, the K-State website and the learning management system, K-State Online. A couple different things we have them do. These are different areas where students use both the website and the learning management system to figure out kind of how to use campus resources. Campus resource activity, so that involves a website. So what we do is we have students, they're already grouped up with one of our upperclassmen education ambassadors. We have them look up, each ambassador's group looks up, like for example, the care office on our campus, counseling services, Lafine Health Center. Students have to go actually to the website and figure out, okay, what are the hours? What are the services? What do the services cost me? And in this way, students can figure out, okay, this is how I actually find these resources. The idea is also that then they can develop skills in problem solving and searching for things that they need to know. Following along with the degree audit, like I said, one of the things we cover in the class is learning how to use your degree audit. So I will actually have students pull out there. We encourage them to bring like a laptop or iPad or other device to class so that they can actually follow through. Okay, as I'm looking at your degree audit, you pull up your degree audit and let's compare. Let's look at what it looks like for you. Graduation plan workshop. We have students do a graduation plan in the class. A big part of that is using the website, using the course catalog, making sure that their classes are in order on the graduation plan. So we actually have them do down here one of the out-of-class assignments, identifying course requisites. Based on their program, they actually have to look up specific courses, the semesters they're offered, the different prerequisites, things like that. So that as they're building their graduation plan, they know how to use the course catalog online, and they're not putting classes out of order or things like that. Once again, it's kind of an exercise in problem solving, teaching students to find the information that they need to be successful at the university. And then, like I said, graduation plan. We try to do, with the graduation plan, we do like a workshop. So the advisors work with the students. That gives the personal touch. That Dr. Morales was talking about. And then with the technology, like I said, that's the piece where, you know, students really want to be able to access information at their fingertips. And so that's where we're teaching them how to use the campus resources like the website. So
that first semester, all of our students are taking the orientation class. It is a required course for them. And so the goal is that they have learned the skills that they need to be successful in planning out their courses and finding the information that they need. Realistically, we know that not every student does that, and they haven't necessarily learned those skills. Our office, at the end of every semester, we get a list of our students who are on academic warning from K-State, which is all of those students who have less than a 2.0 GPA. And that's great information to have because we can look at those students that are at risk. But at the same time, we have selective admission into the professional program, and our students need to have a 2.75 GPA. So a student who's getting a 2.0 or a 2.25 is doing fine for K-State, they're not going to show up on one of our lists telling us that we need to be worried about this student, but they're also not performing at a level where they're going to be able to move on. And so what the university has set up as established limits don't necessarily help us in the way that we're looking at our students. And so that's where we go in and we're using SSC Campus for those predictive analytics. We're looking at some of the search capabilities that are in that system so that we can access students and get lists of students with different GPAs and not just knowing these are our students on warning that we need to reach out to. And also trying to be proactive and working with students before they're getting in trouble and working with what EAB calls the murky middle students. Those ones that you typically never see that are kind of in the middle and there's potential there, but there's potential to go either way, but they're not going to come up on our radars because they're not at risk, they're not on warning, they're not in that traditional list of students that we get. And so once we have that list, it's then using CASIS and getting all of their student demographics and student groups and information to know what are some of those trends, what courses were they struggling in, where do we need to look at to go from there. So basically, at the end of the semester, we run a whole bunch of lists. So our first one is looking at what I'm calling our pre-professional students who are at risk. So our program is divided into that pre-professional and professional. So focusing on our pre-professional students who are at risk, I run a report at the end of the semester searching for all of our students in the pre-professional program who have between a 1.75 and a 2.25. And so looking at those students and saying, these are the ones that are at risk of being successful in our program, and they're ones that we might want to be talking to, not only about those study skills to get them over the 2.0, but also about their major choice. And is education the right place for them? Are we maybe looking at going over to the Career Center and working with some of the students there to find out, you know, or are you in the wrong teaching field that D in biology that you just got, you're not officially on warning, but do you really want to be a biology teacher if you can't get through the initial biology class? And so having some of those conversations saying, you have a 2.25, K-State says you're fine, but there's some other things that are at risk there. So we look at that at risk pre-professional students. I then run a list of those murky middle students, and those are the ones that are between that 2.25 and 2.75. And so those are the ones that we know they're performing below what we're looking for 2.75 admission into the professional program, but there's a real potential that they are able to get there, and we want to be looking at it and again identifying what are those issues. Going into the student center, into CASIS, and saying, what classes was it? Is it a teacher issue? How can we work to make sure that you're focused on class and finding out, are you a first-generation student? Is it an athlete? Are you a transfer student? What pieces of that puzzle do we need to put together to target very specific conversations with those students? And then the third list that I run is the students who are in our professional program. And the students in the professional program, they need to have a 3.0 in all of their teacher education courses, as well as maintain that 2.75 GPA overall in order to be allowed into their student teaching semester. And so I will run a list of all of our students in the professional program who have a GPA under a 3.0. And so I want to be able to looking at that saying they've been successful, they've been admitted into our program, and now all of a sudden we're below a 3.0. Well, I mean, K-State's watch systems are not going to tell me that a student has a 2.98 GPA. But I need to know that because they may potentially not be allowed to student teach the next semester. And we have to do some quick fixes to try and figure out what's going on. So for us, really being able to target very specific student populations that we wouldn't otherwise be able to identify by running some searches. And one of the wonderful things, and we love our K-State IT team and the new advising center that they put together, but that is very focused on our students in our advising list. And so each one of the advisors would have to run a separate list and do some searching to get this information. Whereas using the data mining, the analytics program, the SSE campus, I can run a list for the entire office of all of our education students and then export that into a spreadsheet that we can then all start to look at them and say, this is my student, this is your student, let's put some things together. And so being able to kind of, as an office, work together to do what we need to do with our students and where we want to go. And so this is really kind of our first foray
into doing these, and so really kind of looking at some baseline data is what we were trying to figure out. Sandra is going to talk about some of the things that we decided to do as retention efforts, but for the most part, we were looking at saying, okay, just knowing that we have these students on our radar and saying, let's look at perhaps giving them a little extra attention through the semester, but not necessarily having a concrete plan of you're on this list and therefore you're going to receive action A, B, and C so that we can look at what that intervention is doing. And so just as a baseline, our last list that we did is our Keep It Up group. So running students who have a 3.0, typically a 3.0 for the semester, who had below that, or whose GPA is a 2.5 for the semester, and they were below a 2.0. So running lists and saying, your cumulative GPA is below a 2.5 or below a 2.25, and yet your semester was a 3.0 or a 3.5, and you did awesome. And so being able to then recognize those students who did well and run a list of the students who had an unusually good semester and trying to figure out what that was, but also then writing them a personal note. So we have cards that have pictures from across K-State where each advisor writes a personal note in it saying, congratulations, you had such a great semester, I'm really proud of you. And then the assistant dean, the director of our office, signs the card as well. So they're getting a personal signed card from the assistant dean in the College of Education saying, great work, keep going, we're really proud of what you're doing, so that we can look at that and see where they're going as well. So that is our the last group that we run is that Keep It Up to recognize good work. And so what we found in our murky middle that I ran in January based on fall 2016, at the end of the spring semester, 33 students remained in that murky middle group. So I originally had 87 students on my list that I ran that were in that murky middle at K-State. Or at the College of Education, and at the end of the semester, 33 of them were still there. So they're still, we need to be thinking about, okay, we're still working with you. Four of them dropped down to our watch group. Their GPAs did not improve at all. In fact, their GPAs were not quite so good. So we need to investigate what happened this semester that you're on a downward trajectory. 11 of them were in the Keep It Up group. So 11 of our murky middle students had a great semester that they then, at the end of the semester, got a note saying, awesome work, we're really proud of you. So out of those 87, 11 of them had an amazing semester. 10 of them were accepted into the professional program, and so had got to the point where they had that 2.75 to be able to move forward. None of them were dismissed. And seven of them withdrew. So that means that we did have seven who family issues or finances or one of those big four came into play and they withdrew from the semester. And another seven of them did come to that realization that perhaps education is not for them, that they're not necessarily going to be able to get that 2.75, and hopefully went to a program where they're going to be more successful, that's a better fit for their interests. From our watch group, we had 47 in our watch group. 9 of those remained in the watch group. 8 of them moved up to the murky middle, and so managed to have some kind of improvement. 7 in that Keep It Up group who also had a phenomenal semester and really, really improved. 8 withdrew, 8 changed their program, that hopefully means they're going to be in better success, and we did have 3 dismissed from that group. So we did lose 3 who need to go and spend some time elsewhere rethinking their life goals before they can apply to come back, and we can hopefully work with them again. And so our professional group, watch group, we had 31, 7 of them still in that watch group that we need to be looking at, 11 of them in that Keep It Up that they did really well, and so that means that they are on a good plane to be able to get into student teaching. 1 withdrew, 1 changed their program, realized very late in education that teaching was not the best place for them. And we did have 3 who graduated, so they managed to make it through. And so we're pleased with that as well. And then a new 17 students that we're still watching in the professional program to try and make that through.
Okay, my part. Okay, so retention. So we're using the data that Kelly has mined from SSC, plus something I'm going to talk about that we use on our Canvas online. So the information from SSC gave us, again, the robust search capabilities to find out the students that we're needing to help, ability to identify the at-risk students. And my background is school counseling, and I was an at-risk coordinator, so that's kind of my area to work with those students. And SSC gives us great options for communication. We can text students reminders. They send them emails. If they're on a watch list, they can remind them you need to make an appointment, and they have a certain time that they have to make that appointment to come in. So there's all kinds of capabilities on there to reach out to students, not just with an email from us, but a text message, things like that, which, you know, they're all very texting. So. And then on Canvas, I created a course called Student Success Seminar. And basically, the course is designed to give all of those things that they might have in a first-year seminar class or a strategies class. So it has things like, you know, just the basic study skills, how to take a test, whether it was an essay, multiple choice. I even have, what do you do if a teacher talks too fast, kind of thing. Let's see, I'm trying to think. We have, oh, self-care information in there. So there's a lot of these different modules that we have that they can go through. The first semester, we didn't require them to finish the class. It wasn't a mandatory thing. But this next year, and we'll talk about that in a minute, but we made some changes to it. So what we looked at, the factors, was their GPA, their fall 16 GPA, whether they used the Canvas course that we set up, and then we looked at their spring 17 GPA. And so we looked at most of the people who were on morning went into the group automatically. There were 24 in the murky middle, and the advisors kind of picked and choose, because sometimes the murky middle was, oh, they switched over from biology and they had made a D or an F in biology 198, and so they were like, okay, they really don't need the course. But, and then there were ones who actually did. 15 from the pre-professional group and 11 from the professional group, and there were four that were not in any of them, but recommended by advisors that maybe this is something that they might be benefiting from. Okay, so what we did was the number of students that the GPA increased. So what they did is these 17 students, they had actually accessed the course material. On Canvas, the analytics can show you how many page views that they have, how much time they spent on each page, how much time they spent in the course. And so from that, you can kind of determine, and did they download certain things, that sort of thing. So determining, looking at all that data, 17 students actually accessed course material and used the course material, and the student who spent the most time in the course increased her GPA the most. So that was kind of, you knew that something was working in there. There were three students whose GPA just remained stable, but none of them had accessed the course at all. Okay? They didn't even accept the invitation to the course. I forget what that was, students, I can't see it.
The GPA decreased.
Oh, the GPA
so
decreased.
Students' GPA
okay.
Decreased.
So, and 14 of those students, their GPA did decrease. A lot of them were within the 0.5 range, so they didn't decrease too much, but enough to keep them in the decrease area. And then, again, of those who did not, who decreased a little bit, didn't access the course or didn't use it very much at all. And then we had two that dropped courses but did not withdraw from the university, so they either switched over to another program or just dropped the courses for whatever reason. Two were dismissed from the university, four changed programs, two withdrew from the university, and then we have 10 students who we added that have no data at all. So what we did is we learned that we need to be intentional, we need to be consistent, we need to stop and reflect, keep on learning. So what we've done this semester is change the course to, we're not making it mandatory, but again, we're giving them incentives. So we're giving away gift cards. So if they complete all the modules, they get to be put in a drawing for
have varying amounts of gift cards, $15, $20, $50 gift cards. So they can potentially win money if they finish the course. So that's one of our ways to improve it. I've also added some videos, like Angela Duckworth's grit video, just some things to kind of spice it up a little bit to get them thinking about, why am I not being successful? What can I do to make it better? The other thing that we do is we are warning students. We're requiring them to meet with us twice a month. And so they have to come in for appointments for those. We do have some that meet with us weekly, which is great. And so we just kind of take their temperature to kind of see, you know, what's going on. Like, I had my student come in last week, and she's working 35 hours a week. And I'm like, you can't do that. I know you need the money, but you need to find another way that you can not work so many hours, because that's what's really interfering with what your coursework. So just things like that. So, like, you know, they were talking about that individual, looking at what is making you not be successful. How can we help you to be more successful? And so we look at each student individually to try to figure out what it is that we can do to help them.
And try and work within that stages of change and figuring out, right? The 17 students that didn't access the course at all, well, they're not ready to change. They're not ready to acknowledge that they have that problem. And so now that we can look at the fact and say they didn't, that's a different conversation to have with them than simply saying, here's this course. That those students who jumped on and really accessed the course and said, this is really important, those are the students who were ready for change, who looked at it and said, I need to do this, and so I'm going to take advantage of what's there. And so really being able to, that's the be intentional, is look at each student and try and figure out, where are they and where can we best meet them? The incentives are going to be great if they're kind of in that preparation and thinking about it and almost ready to go, giving them incentive to continue through. But if they're not ready to make a change, then that's not going to help. So trying to figure out where we are in that. And then the being consistent and saying, let's now look at very clearly putting into place what we want to do. So as Sandra said, 2 times a month coming to meet us. And so that's, again, where the technology can help us to create a campaign and put students in a list that says, I need to meet with you, click this button, and then continue to follow up. It will track for us who has made the appointments and who hasn't made the appointments, so that we don't have to run through the list and our schedule and try and match those up. That we've got a little bit more of that record keeping, so that we can be more intentional and more consistent in our follow up with the students, to be able to be more proactive with each individual student and look at, if they don't come, then we can look at that care group in the Office of Student Life and reporting a student of concern, saying this student needs some resources that they're not getting from us, and so look at what are those other things that we can do with that.
The other really cool thing was, because we looked at this over the summer, and we had students who were accessing it over the summer as well, and we knew these students were taking summer courses, so that was kind of really neat to be able to see that they were actually going back and looking at certain things. It's just a nice way to keep track of stuff.
Sandra is going to hand out to you your own puzzle pieces. They are color-coded to match the colors that were originally on our slideshow before we realized they didn't exist. And so what we would like you to do is to work within a group. If you've got a group of 4, kind of switch around. You may not be in the same offices. You may not have the same technology that's there. But what we would like you to do is kind of identify on each puzzle piece, what is a piece of technology that you do have access to that you can use in your advising situation, and start to look at how can we put these different pieces together to maybe come up with something effective in your situation and your reality, which is not necessarily the same as our reality. And so trying to make something that is going to be helpful for you this coming year. And we're happy to answer questions. We'll come back together and have people give some suggestions, some things that they have come up with. And then perhaps if you have any lessons for us that you think that we should have done or could incorporate that will improve what we're doing, we are always happy to get that too.
All about improving. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it may not. Hi, I'm Jessie. I'm in the mechanical nuclear.
Yeah. Nice about the SSC is they have a scheduler, and you know, his name, so you can't say that. Okay, we can have everybody bring their attention back up to the front, please.
Thank you. I love that there were so many great conversations going on, and I'm really excited to hear what you guys came up with. Did we inspire you to think of a new and different way that you can use technology? Does anybody have any suggestions, anything they came up with?
Yes, we talked about the email when you text. Send in a text. I've never heard of that, so I'm going to check at our institution to see if we can do that also.
Okay. Yeah, and I think that the one that we use is part of a much larger program, but there are some smaller programs that you can get that do just text, and so you can look into programs that are just about doing central text messaging back and forth and not having to have all of the other pieces, because I know that budget constraints are a real issue at every institution. So,
yeah. Is that a voice call that turns into a text?
No. So when you go into a student's profile, it says send a message. Mm-hmm. So I click on the button that says send a message, and it says, would you like to send an email or a text message? Mm-hmm. And so if I send the email, then I have the bigger space that I can write out what I want with my subject heading. If I click the other button for the text message, it only gives me so many characters to be able to send. And then it links up with the Student Access Center to find out what their mobile number is and send it to them that way. Yes?
What's the platform that you use for that?
It's SSC Campus from the Education Advisory Board.
But there, like she was saying, there are independent little sites that you can go to that will send. Remind 101 is a very good one. I used that one when I was teaching. And so
we have the easy SSC at KU, but
The foundational SSC that we started working with at K-State didn't. So when we first started working with SSC, we didn't have that text capability. And then Education Advisory Board bought Grades First. And as they incorporated Grades First into their foundational product, they created a new one that's called the SSC Campus. And it's within the campus part of the program that it has that text functionality. When we saw it, when they just rolled into it last year, and we were like, oh my God, we can text our students. We did little happy dances. It was amazing.
And when professors start using Grade First and they're actually putting grades into the system, we will actually be able to see our students' grades and what they're doing, like at midterm. So eventually it will be something that will be very beneficial.
I do really like using the texting capability. I try to do it really sparingly, though, because I know that with kind of like with email, I don't want to just be like sending out a lot of stuff on text messaging. But what I have found is like for the students where I'm like, I need you to make an appointment with me, or you need to, like, if it's something really, really important or something that they're not responding to anything else, that can be really, really helpful, because more often than not, they will respond to a text message. So,
and that's even with our high-achieving students. I work with the honor students and our ambassadors, and one of our best students, who was a representative all over campus, did not respond to emails. he didn't. And so, and his friends and other students would be like, oh yeah, no, if you send him an email, he's not going to answer, but text him, and you'll get something back in 30 seconds. He had his email going to his phone, he just didn't answer them. And so it's really kind of being able to do that. But the other thing that we learned is that the system doesn't tell you who it's from. So it's from a random number. And so when we first started trying that, we didn't know. And Sandra sent a text to one of her veteran students saying, there's an issue with your VA, check your K-State mail. And he was like, okay, who is, like, why are you in and up in my VA business? Like, what's going on?
But he checked his email and found out who it was.
Yeah, so we have started saying, hey, this is Kelly, I need you too, so that we can identify who it is that's getting that. So, yes?
You can text anybody you want through email. It's called SMS messaging system. I've messed around with it a little bit. In fact, I even wrote a kind of a script within Outlook to try to automatically text students that the appointment's coming, although I ran into some issues. But like, if you just go online, I think it's like for Verizon, if there is a Verizon carrier, it's like VTT.net, that you put their number at VTT.net, or you can just put all of them in there, You might get a few undeliverable emails back, but it will send it eventually. Most people use it, they have AT&T, they have Verizon, T-Mobile, Cricket, and yeah, if you really need to text somebody, you can do it through email. You don't need a primary port.
But does it charge them extra fees to do it that way?
Not that I know, it's just a standard text message.
Because I know Remind.com doesn't charge them, because it's an educational service.
It shouldn't, it's just like a regular text, it's an SMS message.
Okay.
Awesome, that is good to know, because I didn't know that.
How do you find that?
If you just type an SMS message email in a Google search, and it'll like give you the addresses. So like, you know, the phone number at att.com or something, and then it'll actually send a text to them.
But then you have to know which
carrier, right. But if you send it to all carriers, it'll go through.
Oh, okay.
But you'll get some, I mean, like I said, if you actually need to, you'll get some undeliverable mail back because that carrier, you know, they don't have that carrier, but it'll get to them. Because, I mean, everyone uses just pretty much the same carriers. Now, if they use like a weird carrier out there that I don't know of, okay, that may happen, but we're talking in general.
Anything else that anybody wanted to share that they have put some thoughts together? Yeah.
I really like, I'm from Butler, and we don't do the departmental advising, but it's really nice that using Canvas, we have Canvas as well, of creating that workshop or the seminar to catch those that are ready for change that will be able to do that, because I think a lot of our retention is reactive, not necessarily proactive, from that one that started at 3.0, dropped to 3.5, dropped to, I mean, catching those to be able to do specific reports and making those seminars was great. I mean, I wrote down a lot of that just to be
able to. I'll tell you where I got a lot of my information.
Ooh, that would be great, because we're actually working on trying to be a little bit more proactive with those to avoid those suspension lessons.
And Lisa, you use Canvas with your advisees. You have an advising Canvas course, right? I had a student.
Right.
Do you have that pulled straight in from your CASIS advising list, or do you individually enter your students and send them the invitation?
We've had to enter them individually.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't know if there's a better way, but I haven't figured it out.
I don't think so.
I think we've been working in the Office of Media and Instruction. Sarah Howe, I know, has been working to try and pull something together, but. That is another thing that you can do, that it's a little time intensive on the front end, and you have to keep up with it to remove students and add them as they come and go. But I have that with my honors students as well, that I have a course that I've created for them on Canvas to be able to kind of have them all in one place and keep that communication in one place together. So, yeah.
Any suggestions for us?
Anything that you looked at and said, that was stupid, why did you do that? That was really
right
not the plan. Yes, good.
So I just have a question. So I work at Wichita State, so we have a million platforms, as you guys do